Okay. Now here is a picture of a much more destruction of the glomeruli. That's why it's called as diffuse glomerulosclerosis, as you can see. So there could be nodular or diffuse. So that's the reason why in the end stage renal disease you have a bilaterally contracted kidney and which is having this pathology of diffuse glomerulosclerosis. Look at this picture where there is a different staining, and this is a nodular glomerulosclerosis which has been depicted. You see the destruction, and of course at this stage the patient will be having a nephrotic range of proteinuria, and there will be a steady fall in the glomerular filtration rate, and which will ultimately lead to elevation of serum creatinine and then bilaterally contracted kidneys with the loss of corticomedullary differentiation. The KW nodules have been shown here. It's almost looking like a smooth hyalinization here, and as you can see here. Look at this picture, which it's a microscopic microphotograph of a histopathological slide of the normal glomerular apparatus, which is showing the capillaries which are normal in size. And look at this nodules which are there in the diseased glomeruli or the pathological glomeruli, which we call sclerosis. Look at the size of what has happened. They have become minute here. And nodular diabetic glomerulosclerosis will also afflict the vessels, as we know, microvascular. And all of the vessels have become, or the small capillaries have become, much further smaller, and they are distorted also in shape. That's why the filtration ability gets afflicted here. That's the reason why GFR starts dropping. Let's look at the phases. As I said, hyperfiltration. At this stage, in fact, there could be a slight amount of increase in the size of the kidney. Sometimes we call it as nephromegaly. But this is very transient. You don't have to get carried away with this. And at this stage, in fact, there's an increased glomerular filtration rate. And microalbuminuria, proteinuria, heavy proteinuria with nephrotic syndrome or renal failure. Hypertension develops virtually in all of these patients because of the stimulation here of this cascade of different mechanisms, where the renal mechanisms are completely shut down and the renin-angiotensin aldosterone axis is afflicted. And non-diabetic renal disease also can produce proteinuria, but you need to rule out other treatable causes along with diabetic nephropathy evaluation. Diabetic nephropathy treatment, let's come to the treatment. As the disease progression is going on, with the ability to pinpoint and diagnose early stage of diabetic nephropathy, we need to make sure that there's an optimum strict blood glucose control throughout, either by usage of oral drugs or insulin. Control of blood pressure, a very tight monitoring and control of blood pressure, wherein we need to maintain the blood pressure according to the guidelines to less than 130 by 80 millimeters of mercury. Or if there is a significant proteinuria, you need to keep it at the level of as low as 125 by 75 millimeters of mercury. And the best drugs of choice are the AC inhibitors or angiotensin receptor blockers if the patient cannot tolerate AC inhibitors. And if the blood pressure is not optimally controlled with one line therapy, then you need to add on other antihypertensives. Maintenance of fluid and electrolyte balance is very essential throughout, and as the disease has progressed and if it reaches end stage, we need to move on to renal replacement therapy. Now, few words about systemic lupus erythematosus producing lupus nephritis. We know that disease spectrum in Malaysian setting, especially in our hospital based medicine, as students we have shown you in the bedside teaching many patients of different spectrum suffering from systemic lupus erythematosus under rheumatology wards. The renal involvement is again here as high as 30% within the first year of diagnosis and 20% by another 20%, that means by fifth year of the disease, as many as half the patients, 50% of them can be afflicted with lupus nephritis. Of course, it depends on the staging. It varies from the isolated abnormalities of a urinary sediment. Here, you should remember, the urinary sediment in SLE is called as telescopic cast. You get all kind of casts here, RBC, WBC, hyaline, protein, etc. And the patient may also come to us with the presentation of nephrotic syndrome, full blown, nephritic because hematuria will be there, or chronic kidney disease itself. The mechanism of glomerular injury mainly here is different, and it is the immune complex deposition which happens within the glomerular capillary wall, and there will be a lot of thrombotic microangiopathy, and especially in a disease like APLA syndrome, etc. So the main thing in lupus nephritis is immune complex deposition. As I said, we do classify the lupus nephritis based on histopathology, of course. So renal biopsy is essential to see at what stage your patient is. Class 1, class 2. Class 2 is further classified as class 2A, class 2B. And here I am telling you class 1 is having a normal light microscopy. Immunofluorescence only shows mesangial deposits. Class 2, mesangial lupus nephritis, because we are going one step further. Means the, as the disease progresses, the class is divided. And you have multiple deposition of immunoglobulins and complements C3. And 2A will be normal by light microscopy, but 2B will have mesangial hypercellularity. That's an added problem. After the immune complex has started the cascade, you start having this problem. And this will result in microscopic hematuria and 25 to 50% moderate proteinuria. In fact, at these stages, the survival is excellent. More than 90% will have 5-year survival, and of course they will be benefited if the treatment is started on time. Class 3 will have focal segmental proliferative lupus nephritis, I used to short forms, with nephrosis or sclerosis affecting less than 50% of the glomeruli. You still have other 50%. And 30% of these class 3 patients will come with nephrotic syndrome, and 15 to 25% would have already had a impaired GFR. Class 4 is a diffuse proliferative lupus nephritis with crescent formation, which is a sinister sign in most glomeruli. And fibrinoid necrosis with wire loops, very classical due to GBM thickening and mesangial interposition between basement membrane and endothelial cells. In fact, we have deposition of IgA also addition, IgM, IgG and complement C3. Class 5 will have a membranous lupus nephritis in total, and thickening of the GBM is seen very well by the light microscopy, and electron microscopy will show a subepithelial deposition in addition to subendothelial and mesangial deposition. And these patients with class 5, more than 90% of them come with nephrotic syndrome, and less than 10% already have impaired GFR at the time of presentation. And class 6 is end stage proliferative lupus nephritis. It has a diffuse glomerular sclerosis and advanced tubular interstitial disease sets in here. I've shown you here the histopathology. You can see the damage and the destruction. It's almost causing the diffuse membrane destruction and crescent formations. As I said, whenever we have lupus nephritis, the renal involvement is there in SLE. It already indicates a poor prognostication for SLE itself. And ANA positivity will be there in 95% of the patients. Anti-dsDNA, which is very specific for SLE, need to be done, and anti-smooth muscle will be positive too. And there is a need for many more further aggressive therapy for lupus nephritis. And if we do this early intervention in SLE, the progression to renal failure can be postponed or prevented too. And we need to look at the side effect profile of all the drugs, which is essential because we are going to give them for long term in systemic lupus erythematosus. High doses of steroids will be given, so they will produce toxicity. Cytotoxic agents are going to be used, and they will produce, like you all know already, the bone marrow suppression, susceptibility to infections, subfertility, secondary malignancy, etc. Now coming to the treatment for specific stages of SLE. It's not indicated in class 1 and most of class 2, but class 3 and 4 require corticosteroids, cyclophosphamide. Azathioprine can be given. Mycophenolate mofetil, they have started using it in Malaysia. ACE inhibitors to protect renal protection and renal replacement therapy. Now let's summarize what we have learned today. based on our learning outcomes. So now we will be able to define primary and secondary nephrotic syndrome. We'll be able to list the etiopathogenesis of these conditions, and we can enumerate the clinical features and correlate them with the clinical conditions in the problem-based scenarios or in real-life patients. And we are unable to pick up the acute and chronic complications of nephrotic syndrome. We are able to ask specific investigations with reasoning and able to treat the patient and prevent the complications suitably or aptly on time. And thank you all.